Greetings, everyone. I feel like I should say happy Sunday morning to you. But it's Wednesday afternoon here while I'm recording this, and of course that's just how we're having to do things these days. And I want to just tell you something, church, is that I am struggling with this. I am struggling with us not meeting together, and I'm certain that some of you are as well. I hope all of you are struggling with this. I hope we're missing this and mourning what we've lost that we won't get back. I hope that we miss the glorious sound of hearing one another sing as we sing God's songs to one another. I hope that you miss the hush that falls over us when we pray together, perhaps only broken by the sound of one of our little ones cooing or crying, which is beautiful in and of itself. And I hope you miss what's happening when the Holy Spirit teaches us as a group, as a gathered congregation, as a gathered body, when we hear God's word taught. And I hope we miss coming together for the Lord's table. It's hard to be apart. But we pray that God in his sovereignty will use this time. And you know, I really sense that God is doing something through us, and we need to open ourselves to him, because what we're doing here is wonderful. It's like I mentioned last week. It's like being able to Skype or FaceTime with a grandchild that's not present with you. But it is certainly not the same as picking up that child and holding them and hugging them yourself. And this, I praise God that we can do this, but remembering that this is not church. You cannot do church online. And so I just, as we struggle through this together, I want us to perhaps be in a season of sadness in part. We don't have to go around all glum and everything, but I think there should be some lamenting taking place for what we are missing. But one thing that we're not missing is our call to the Great Commission. And I don't know exactly what that's supposed to look like right now. And that's another thing that I'm struggling with and looking for answers. How do we go about doing this thing that God has commanded us to do? And I struggle sharing it even through this medium. And as it is April 1st, as I'm doing this, and I read Charles Spurgeon's Morning and Evening, written in the 1800s, and just incredibly relevant even today. And he talks about struggling, getting a message across using pen and paper. And so I appreciate his struggle with that. But as this will be played, Lord willing, on the first Sunday in April, let me share this with you. If you are a Christian, well, first let me say this. If you're not a Christian, these words are directly for you, for your own self. So hear what the great Prince of Preachers had to say. If you are a Christian, then hear these words deeply and let them inform how you talk to others who may not be saved. This is a great message that Charles Spurgeon shares. He says this. He starts with Hosea 10:12, and it says, "It is time to seek the Lord." This month of April is said to derive its name from the Latin verb aperio, which signifies to open, because all the buds and blossoms are now opening, and we've arrived at the gates of a flowery season. If you are yet unsaved, may your heart, in accord with the universal awakening of nature, be open to receive the Lord. Every blossoming flower warns you that it is time to seek the Lord. Be not out of tune with nature, but let your heart bud and bloom with holy desires. Do you tell me that the warm blood of youth leaps in your veins? Then I entreat you, give your energy to the Lord. It was my unspeakable happiness to be called an early youth, and I could greatly praise the Lord every day for it. Salvation is priceless, let it come when it may. But oh, an early salvation has double value in it. Young men and women, since you may perish before you reach your prime, it is time to seek the Lord. You who feel the first signs of decay quickening your pace, the hollow cough, that hectic flush, they are warnings that you must not trifle with. With you, it is indeed time to seek the Lord. Did I observe a little gray mingled with your once luxurious tresses? Years are stealing on apace, and death is drawing nearer by hasty marches. Let each return of spring arouse you to set your house in order. If you are now advanced in life, let me entreat you and implore you, delay no longer. There is a day of grace for you now. Be thankful for that, but it is a limited season and grows shorter every time the clock ticks. Here in this silent chamber on this first night of another month, I speak to you as best I can by paper and ink from my inmost soul. As God's servant, I lay before you this warning. It is time to seek the Lord. Slight not that work. It may be your last call from destruction, the final syllable from the lip of grace. And amen. And again, if you're not saved, those words are for you. And just because this is a recording doesn't mean you can't pick up the phone and call me or talk to someone there in your home. It is time to seek the Lord. And if you are a Christian, I can send you those words, or you can find, just look for Charles Spurgeon's Morning and Evening. It's free online, and look for April 1st evening and grab those words and, you know, modernize them a little bit to make them part of your own conversation. But that's a great way to share the gospel with someone. And now, friends, let us hear the word of the Lord from the 8th Psalm. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babies and infants, you have established strength because of your foes to still the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you care for him? Yet you have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings, and crowned him with glory and honor. You have given him dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, also the beasts of the field, the birds of the heavens, the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the seas. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
Oh, shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
Now I'm going to ask all the children to gather around for the children's message. Hey guys, another week where you can see me and I can't see you. And I don't like that. I miss you so much. And I can't wait till we can see one another again. And I want you to know that I'm praying for you all the time. I'm praying for your families. I'm praying for you to see Jesus all around you. Well, today I'm going to read you another story from this great book we've been looking at called Everyone a Child Should Know. This is a book of biographies, which means they are true stories about real life people. And Claire Heath White wrote these stories, and Jenny Brake drew the pictures on the inside. Today we are going to hear about a very special woman whose name is Johnny Erickson Tada. Her name is spelled J-O-N-I, and a lot of people do pronounce that Joni, but she pronounces it Johnny. And this is a picture of what Jenny Brake says that Johnny looks like. And I want you to see something. Can you see real close here? Very interesting. She has a paintbrush in her mouth. Wonder what that's about. Let's see if we can find out. This starts with a Bible verse. My comfort in suffering is this, your promises preserve my life. And that's from Psalm 119, verse 50. Johnny Erickson Tada was born in 1949, and she's still alive. Do you like running and jumping? Do you like swimming and kicking a ball around? Johnny Erickson Tada liked all those things too. She liked to run and swim and ride horses and play tennis. But then one day, she dove into a lake and she hurt her neck. She hurt her neck so badly that she couldn't move her legs or her feet. She couldn't move her arms or her hands either. That made Johnny very sad. Then she remembered her friend Jesus. She knew that Jesus was with her and that he loved her. She knew that bad things happened to Jesus too, and so he understood. She knew that one day, when she went to live with her friend Jesus forever, she would be able to run and jump again. So Johnny has spent her life telling people about her friend Jesus, in books, on the radio, in talks, through pictures painted with a brush in her mouth. That's what this picture is about here. She paints cards and drawings and all sorts of things with paint and a paintbrush that she puts in her mouth. Isn't that amazing? Johnny has told people how Jesus is always with her, always loves her, and always helps her. She has told them how Jesus loves everybody, whether they can run or not, whether they can jump or not, whether they can see or not, whether they can hear or not. And one day, Jesus' friends will all run and jump and hear and see when they live with him forever. Isn't that a great story? It helps us remember, I think, that everyone can turn to Jesus, and Jesus loves everyone regardless of whether they can do the same things we can do or not. So older people and younger people in wheelchairs and people that have to have canes and seeing eye dogs or hearing aids or can't hear at all, they can all find Jesus, and he will love them. And then in heaven, all of the problems we have with all of our bodies will all go away. Let's pray about that. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for these children, and I miss them. And even though I'm not seeing them, you see them all the time, and you're with them all the time. So Lord, help us all to remember that anyone can come to you and be your friend. Anyone can come to you. It doesn't matter if we're big and strong or small and weak, or if we have to be in a wheelchair, or if we can't see or we can't hear, you can save anyone. So Lord, help us to love people like you love them, all people. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you guys, and I can't wait to see you again. And now for everyone, let's take a few minutes and go to the Lord in prayer. And gracious God, we know that we pray where we are, and our prayers transcend time and space, and they go to the throne room of heaven where you hear us, where your Holy Spirit seeks our hearts, our souls, our minds, and everything that's weighing heavily on us, all of our needs, and brings them to you. And that's true for all of your people. So Lord, as odd as it is that I'm now praying to you, and it's a few days before people hear this prayer, it doesn't change anything. You still hear our prayers. And so for each individual that's sitting somewhere watching this, and each family that's gathered together watching this, Lord, I just ask that you would bless them where they are. If anyone is lonely, be an evident presence in their home. And then for the rest of us, may we reach out to people who are lonely. For those of us who are together and there may be some stress because of, you know, just being stuck in the house all the time, Lord, just ask that you would bring your presence and your peace. Lord, help us to miss the things we should be missing about being together. Help us to rejoice, to be content in all circumstances, to be glad to do the things we can do, and at the same time, missing the things that we should be missing. Our gathered singing, our gathered prayer, our gathered hearing your word taught, our preparation to be dispersed out into the world to fulfill your great commission. And Lord, give us opportunities, even in this, whether it's by some sort of electronic device or a phone call, whether it's standing 6 feet away from someone at a checkout line or across on the other side of the gas pump, whether it's a neighbor that we're just kind of speaking to at a distance, you can very rapidly close the distance between us, even if we stay 6 feet apart. So Lord, we ask that you would use us. Give us opportunities to share the gospel. Give us opportunities to reveal your glory. Lord, use this time. Use us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So we are returning today to our look at the seven I am statements in the Gospel of John. Last week we looked at Jesus saying, I am the bread of life. Lord willing, we will continue looking at these for the next few weeks. Jesus saying, I am the door. I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the true vine. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And today, looking at Jesus saying, I am the light of the world. And we pointed out last week, you may remember, that when Jesus said, I am, in these seven situations, he wasn't saying the same thing as if he said, I am going to Jerusalem. He wasn't just talking about his state of being, like if I say I am happy or I am a pastor or I am going to the store. No, this I am, the usage of these words and the context that they were given reflect back to Moses at the burning bush and the voice of God coming out. And Moses saying, if I go back to the nation of Israel and I say that I was sent to lead them out of slavery, who shall I say sent me? And the voice of God said, I am who I am. Tell them, I am has sent you. This is God saying that he has always been and always will be. He's not created. Like, we are something that has been created. His I am is not having been created. God exists outside of time and outside of space and outside of creation. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, all I am. And so when Jesus says this, I am in this way, he is calling in something, calling on something much greater than just, a personal pronoun and a verb. He's making a statement about who he is. So in John 8, we're going to look at John 8, 12 and some of the surrounding verses, and then over to John 9, 5, Jesus saying this same thing twice. And Father God, as we go into your word, may we indeed remember that this is the living and active word of the living and active God. And even in the midst of this global pandemic, when the world seems dark in so many ways and our eyes seem dark because we can't see the end of this, let us look to the light of the world. Speak to us now. In Christ's name, amen. So this in John is right after the story of the woman who was caught in adultery and they came and they were going to stone her to death and they try to test Jesus with what does the law say? And Jesus responds with, let he who is without sin cast the first stone. And so that story ends. And then it says, again, Jesus spoke to them saying, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have light of life. Remember, Jesus said, bread of life. And we said that when we're physically hungry, right, we take in food. We eat a good meal, and that calms our hunger. When we are anxious and fearful and sinful and greedy and angry and all those sorts of things, that's a spiritual hunger, sort of. And what we do, we feast upon the bread of life. And it pushes those things away. So Jesus is saying, I am the light of life. So the Pharisees said to him, you are bearing witness about yourself. Your testimony is not true. Jesus answered, even if I do bear witness about myself, my testimony is true. For I know where I came from and where I am going. But you do not know where I come from or where I am going. You judge according to the flesh. I judge no one. Yet even if I do judge, my judgment is true. For it is not I alone who judge, but I and the Father who sent me. And he's getting ready to bring something up out of the law about having two witnesses. And two witnesses were considered, if they said the same thing, that was considered truth. He says this, in your law it is written that the testimony of two people is true. I am the one who bears witness about myself, and the Father who sent me bears witness about me. They said to him, therefore, where is your Father? Jesus answered, you know neither me nor my Father. If you knew me, you would know my Father also. Jesus says, I am the light of life. And then going over to chapter 9, this is a story of the man born blind, and this is very interesting aspect of the light here. This is a man who did not receive light into his eyes, right? And Jesus answers the question, why is he blind? Who sinned? Him? His parents? And Jesus says, It was not that, I'm picking up at verse 3, chapter 9, it was not that this man sinned or his parents, but that the works of God might be displayed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. And then Jesus goes about healing this man and bringing light into his eyes, actual light. But Jesus says again here, I am the light. This time he says, I am the light of the world, the light of life and the light of the world. And this makes us think back to John 1, I think, where Jesus is being spoken about by John initially. In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him. Without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life. That life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness shall not overcome it. Then down to verse 9. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. So John is saying the same thing here that Jesus is saying in chapters 8 and 9, that those who are resisting him, those who are not believing in him, they don't understand who he is, and they are rejecting the light. They are rejecting the light. We cannot see without light. And I think we have lost a little bit of that reality, because very rarely are we anywhere where it is truly dark, truly without light. Streetlights streaming through the crack in bedroom curtains, right? There's a little bit of light there. There's the light from the smoke detector battery. There's the light from the cell phone charger. We go out at night. You have to really find a remote area to be away from the lights of the city. I go out walking near where we live, and there are no street lights where I'm walking. Like, I can't even see a street light, but I can look over toward the city of Camden, and I can look over toward Dover, and I can look over toward Dover Air Force Base, and I see a halo of light all the time. 2, 3 in the morning, midnight, 6 in the morning, before the sun comes up, you can see a halo of light glowing everywhere. It's hard for us to understand what true darkness is. But if you've ever been a place where it was completely dark, if you've been blindfolded, been put in a room somewhere where all the light was sealed out, and you try to maneuver, you try to move around, you know how difficult it is. And so it is spiritually for those who don't have Christ. The difference is they think they can see. They think they're getting along just fine, but they cannot. They are not seeing reality. So when we're told that we walk by faith and not by sight, it's not that blind faith, it's that faith increases our ability to see. What we see through the eyes of faith is greater than what we see with our own eyes. We are talking about these things for however many weeks God would keep us in this situation, because I think the greatest thing we can do to alleviate our own fear and anxiety and to be a gospel witness in the world is to so focus on Christ, to so stare at Christ, to gain all of him we can, that it just washes that other stuff out of us and it makes us more Christ-like, so that when we're out places, people get a glimpse of something that's way different than what they're used to dealing with. So that now, with all the things that they are typically confident in are gone, unreachable. Things are so uncertain. And here we come. We should be different. We should be bringing calm and peace, assurance, hope, not like hoping, oh, I hope I get a pony when you're 5. Hope that is true belief of what is going to happen, just not yet happened. We have that as Christians, and we should carry that in where we go, wherever we go. And you've seen scenarios like this. You may have been the person in a scenario like this where there's been confusion, maybe at work, where people just didn't know what to do and no one knows how to do this one thing and that thing has to be done before anybody else can do it. And then in strides that one person who's the expert in that, and you're like, ah, she's here now or he's here now. Now we can get something done. Well, that's the way it should be when a Christian walks in to a non-Christian arena. They may not know that, but they will sense that we carry something different. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. As long as I'm here, I am the light of the world. Well, we know that not too long after this, Jesus was not going to be here in the physical sense anymore. So what then? What do we make of the world in darkness? That we as Christians have the light of Christ, but what of everyone else? Well, that takes us back to Matthew 5, the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus has said, you're salt of the earth. And then in verse 14, he says to his followers, you are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all that in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven, that they may look at what you're doing and give glory to God. Well, that tells us one thing about motivation. It also tells us how we should present good works, right? Because what we want is people looking at us and seeing God, and that's easier than it may sound. Many of you have probably heard me use this before, and it's because it's one of my favorite. I don't think it's actually a metaphor. I think it's actually a reality. It's something that God put in place in creation to teach us something about himself. We look at a piece of art, we can know something about the artist. We look at the world, that tells us about the creator. So we go back to Genesis 1, and we have God making things, right? And he creates light before he creates anything that is lit, right? He creates light first, and then he creates two lights. He does the sun and the stars, and the moon and stars. He does all those things, but he proclaims two things, specifically the sun and the moon, right? One is the great light, which rules the day, and the second is the lesser light that rules the night. And what we have come to know over time is that the sun is a source of light in and of itself. The sun burns, it's a flame, and it creates light. The moon does not. We see the moon because it reflects the light of the sun. So in the daytime, we have the great light, and at night, we have the lesser light. So Jesus says, right, I am the light of the world as long as I am here. But he also said to us, you are the light of the world. And he said, as long as I'm here, I'm the light of the world. And when I'm gone, it's going to be night. And I think very clearly we take from that Jesus is the greater light. He is a source of light in and of himself. As a matter of fact, when we read into Revelation 21, we will see that there is no temple in the New Jerusalem, and there was no sun in the New Jerusalem, because Jesus was the thing the temple was always created to point to, and he is the light. The glory of God's the light, and Jesus is the lamp from which that light shines. So, in the time of darkness, we're the light of the world. You and I, Christians, are the light of the world. But what's that mean? Well, if we go back to the creation story, if we can infer from that any light that's showing at night is a lesser light, which obviously it is. If it was the great light, it wouldn't be night, right? So we are lesser lights. So where must we get our light? Well, we must face the greater light and reflect it. That's what Jesus is saying here. Let your light shine before others so they may see your good works and give glory to the Father. Like, when we may not often stop and think of this, but when we do stop and think about it, we look at the moon, and we should understand, right? That sunlight we're seeing reflected off the moon. So we reflect the light of Christ into the world. So we want people, when they see something from us, some good work from us, some peace that comes from us, we don't want them to go, oh, isn't that person wonderful? So what is the source of that light? That's just a person, and people don't have that. What is that? Yeah, that's reflection of Christ. That's me staring at Christ and Christ reflecting off me. So I get the light, but then somebody else also gets the light. And I think, and again, many of you have heard me use this before because I think it's so important for us to understand. As we watch the moon go through its phases, right? As the month moves along, we have a full moon, and then, you know, a three-quarter and a half, and then that little sliver moon, right? The crescent moon. And what has happened there? Well, what has happened is that it's reflecting less light from the sun. Why? There's a shadow on it. What's the shadow from? From the world. When the world gets between the moon and the sun, the moon reflects much less light. And I think, brother and sister, that is a lesson for us to learn. That we need to so fully face Christ and not let the world get in the way. That when the world gets between us and Christ, some light may get past us and less depending on how much of the world we're letting get in the way. And the grave concern is less and less until there's a total eclipse, right? Where people look at us and don't see Jesus at all. And in a crisis like we're going through right now, that is of such possibility. It's such a great possibility because we get consumed with worry. We get consumed with the news, and we think we know what this person should do, and we think we know what that person should not do, and we think we know how all these things should work. When really, as Christians right now, and unless our job is specifically to be doing those things, if we're hired to do those things, we can certainly have opinions, but what should we be doing? We should be just paying enough attention to the news to know what the rules are today, and if there's some medicine we should be taking, and there's a place we should go or not go. I mean, we should be alert to what's happening, but it should be very little, and we should be just soaking in as much Christ as we can. We should be praying more. We should be reading the Bible more. We should be getting out our hymnals and singing Christian songs to ourselves or with one another, but in worship of God. We should be talking to one another, whether it's people in your house that you can talk to safely, or whether it's on FaceTime or Skype or just on the phone. We should be immersing ourselves in Christ. We should be putting ourselves so fully towards Christ because the darkness is impinging upon us. There's a shadow trying to come over and eclipse us. But see, we don't have to stay in that shadow. We can move. We can move and stay in the light of Christ. And if we will do that, we will be better off ourselves. We will be better off because we're receiving the full light of Christ. But not only us, those around us, those with whom we are communicating, those people who are 6 feet away in the checkout line, those people who are on the other side of the gas pump, those people that are seeing our social media post, what are they getting? They will be getting the light of Christ. They'll look at what we say and look at what we do and look at the peace that we have and look at the hope that we have, look at the fact that we can smile in the midst of this. Now, what is that? Well, let me tell you what that is. That's not me. I by nature, I'm a worrier, or by nature, I get angry and things like this. By nature, I want to say this and do that and point my fingers and do those things. But I've gotten myself out of the way because I want you to see Christ. I want you to see Christ. I want you to know who he is. Because, friends, he is the light of the world. When this sun goes out, as one day it will, Christians will not be in the dark. We will be living in the light of the glory of God and of its lamp, which is the Lamb. brothers and sisters, focus on Christ for yourselves and focus on Christ to be a gospel witness to others. Gracious God, help us, Lord. Help us, we pray. Help us to turn and move out of the darkness and into the light, into your marvelous light. Yes, so that we may receive, but also that we may be lights in the darkness, that we may be a lamp setting on a hill in the darkness that draws attention of others, that we may point them to you. In Jesus' name. As we close this out, I do so hoping that the amount of times we have to do this are few. I hope that we are back together again soon. I ask that you continue to pray for your church. Continue to pray for one another. Pray for us as a whole, as a church. Pray for individuals in our church. Pick up the phone and call somebody in the church or connect with them some other way. Let people know that this church is important to you, and as another member of this church, that person is important to you as well. And again, in the midst of this, with what extra time you have, turn yourselves toward Christ. Pray. Read the Bible. Read good Christian books. There are tons and tons of free resources online to listen to watch, and to read. If not, you're allowing the darkness to come across your face and limit the amount of light of Christ that you're shining to the world. When the day comes that we stand before Jesus, don't we want to hear, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant"? You looked at the light, and you showed the light. So friends, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. Make his face to shine upon you. And may he be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you, give you all the health, happiness, wholeness, all that is peace with God. May he give you shalom. And one more thing, as his face shines upon you, may you radiantly shine his face to the world. Amen.